Well, thank you very much and greetings to you all. It's a great pleasure to preside over this session virtually and a privilege to have Dr. Abdullah with us at such a potentially pivotal moment for Afghanistan and for the U.S.-led coalition that has supported Afghanistan since late 2001. Dr. Abdullah Abdullah is known well to many of us, a Kabul University-trained ophthalmologist who originally practiced in Western Pakistan during the Soviet occupation, before joining Ahmad Shah Massoud and the Panjshir resistance. When the Taliban captured Kabul in 1996, he served with the Northern Alliance, again under Ahmad Shah Massoud, and following liberation of Afghanistan from the Taliban in late 2001, Dr. Abdullah served for 4 years as the Minister of Foreign Affairs. He ran for president in 2009, of course, and then led the opposition in parliament. Following the 2014 election, he served as chief executive in the Government of National Unity. And in May of this year, following another contested election, he was selected to lead the High Council for National Reconciliation with authority to handle all affairs related to the Afghan peace process, negotiations over which have, of course, begun recently in Doha, Qatar. Welcome, Dr. Abdullah Abdullah. It's great to see you again.
Thank you, General Petraeus. Good to see you. And thank you for presiding over this important virtual get-together. Good to see you.
Thank you. And it's great to do it from this undisclosed lakeside location in Virginia. Doctor, perhaps we could begin with you giving us a quick update on the state of the talks with the Taliban in Doha, please.
Thank you. I should say that after 42 years of war, the start of talks in Doha, I consider it historic. It started well. It continues now as we are speaking. The contact groups are meeting one another, and there will be a get-together of the two teams, the whole team. We started from knowing one another, like our two teams, and then getting along and how to raise issues and so on and so forth. The atmosphere, considering the background, I should consider it is healthy. We sense that there is a willing in the other side, which is the Taliban movement, to take advantage of that situation and contribute. But a long way ahead of us. Nobody can ignore all the complexities involved. We come, both sides come from two different worldviews, views about the life, about rights of citizens, about the our vision of our own country, and in all of that. At the same time, we have come together with all those differences to find a way to live in peace with one another and maintain our differences of views and let the people decide about it in the future. But at the same time, put an end to the misery of the people which have continued for so long. Personally, I have been involved in this in the past four decades, one way or another. There is no more urgency for a peaceful settlement than one would see for the people of Afghanistan. That's important. And at the same time, the United States also is looking at it with a sense of urgency at this stage, which is a good convergence of views there. Meanwhile, in the past 19 years, you have supported us, the international community has supported us, the United States, your own service here in our soil, men and women and soldiers, those who paid the ultimate price. This has created a bond of friendship between both countries based on the common threat that we were faced, because it was after 2001 one, the tragedies of 9/11, that you started your engagement here. I see that Mr. Richard Haas is the president of the CFR. I met him in 2001 before September 11th. At that time, Richard Haas was the director of policy planning at the State Department. And I remember very vividly at that time that what I raised with him was that, yes, as Afghans, we are going through very, very difficult times. But there are terrorist groups working in Afghanistan, which tomorrow, their aim is, of course, at the moment, we are in the front line, but their aim is the United States or the Western civilization. That was like a few months before September 11th. And then came the tragedies, and we also lost, prior to September 11th, the leader of the resistance just 2 days before that, late Ahmad Shah Massoud. A few days back was its anniversary. Since then, we have come a long way. While peaceful settlement in Afghanistan is in the interest of everybody, but nobody would like to see the terrorist groups taking root once again in this soil and then creating havoc and misery for the people around the world. One important part of the agreement signed between the United States and Taliban is the Taliban severing links with Al-Qaeda in terrorist groups. That has to be observed one has to make sure that that part of the agreement is implemented fully, because it's important for us, it's important for the rest of the world, and for the sacrifices that you have made or other partners have made in this country. I know that the negotiations will have its own complexities. There will be spoilers around. There will be people which may worry about certain things. But as a whole, I can say that the people of Afghanistan are hopeful. At the same time, they have concerns. Do we go back to the old days? What happens to the gains of the people of Afghanistan, which is as a result of too many sacrifices here from us Afghans and our friends of and partners? Can we get to a point where while maintaining our views and way of life, agreed to live in peace within a country, a sovereign country, without allowing terrorist group, without resorting to violence, and then compete for our ideas peacefully and politically? That's the aim. And the other side of it has been that if we don't get there, then it will be the continuation of the agony, misery, suffering, migration, in all sorts of other situations that we have been through, that will continue. So it's a moment of being hopeful, at the same time, one shouldn't lose sight of all those risks which are involved, eventually and ultimately, the absolute majority of our people are for dignified, durable peace, a country which is unified and does not harbor terrorist groups and respects the rights of its own citizens and contribute to the well-being of its own people, but at the same time materialize those potentials, economic and otherwise, which will be beneficiary for the region and beyond.
Doctor, when you talk about the rights of Afghans, of course, 50% of the Afghans, the women, had few, if any, rights under Taliban rule. What is your sense as to whether or not the gains, the enormous gains that women have made since late 2001, will be sustained in this new arrangement that is being developed?
I would say that, you know, there are very different views when we are talking about two sides, Taliban movement in the Islamic Republic. And at the same time, these changes or gains as far as the women's rights is concerned, these are not superficial. This has taken its roots in different parts of the country. That's not limited to the cities, to the urban areas of the country. Some of those things, including freedom of speech, those are not reversible. That depends on our ability to accept one another's ideas, but at the same time compete for it, as I mentioned, contest for it politically without resorting to violence. In that sense, I would say that the absolute majority of the people of Afghanistan are supportive of the women's rights, including the people would not go back to the days that they will not be able to send their girls to school or any other situation which was imposed upon the people. These will be the tough issues in the negotiating table, those are the things that majority assemble around and are supportive.
I know that the negotiations are still really just in the preliminary stages, agenda and so forth. Is there any sense yet that, again, women's rights will truly be achievable in these negotiations? Do you have any inclination so far?
The point is that we might not be able to convince Taliban or persuade them to accept everything that we say, and at the same time, Taliban will not be able to convince us for their own ideas. The idea is to cease fighting, to not to use violence, and at the same time, they should accept that things have changed in the past 20 years, especially when one of the leaders, which was part of the insurgency, but later on joined as Mr. Hikmatyar. When he joined us in the first day, when he was in Kabul, my message to him was that, Mr. Hikmatyar, Afghanistan is a very different Afghanistan since we last met, which was like 20-some years back. And part of that is the youth, the women, the civil society, the free media, the vibrant private sector, in all of this, for us to deserve to lead the country, we should accept that things are different and embrace those changes, which are not reversible. So those things, issues will be debated, there are women in the negotiating team, prominent women members of the negotiating team on behalf of the Islamic Republic, but those will not be left to those four member distinguished women representatives, but all those which are there will be lining up when it comes to the rights of women, including the ulamas, which are part of our team as well.
You talk about the cessation of hostilities. Of course, it's not just the Taliban, again, who have been making life difficult for Afghanistan, sadly. It's also the Haqqani network, sometimes the Haqqani Taliban, it's termed, the Tariqi Taliban Pakistani, the IMU, of course, Al-Qaeda, the Islamic State. Can the Taliban speak for more than, first of all, can the Taliban speak for all of its own members in this negotiation? And second, does it speak for any of these other groups, or will they also have to be dealt with at some point down the line, noting that, again, Al-Qaeda and the Islamic State will be unacceptable to any?
Yeah, the Taliban, to be To be fair to them, they do represent, as far as their own organization, their own movement is concerned, including Haqqani group, they do represent. Their representatives are there also in the negotiating team or around the negotiations over there. So that might not be the main question. The main question will be what happens to Al-Qaeda. I mentioned, I referred to this earlier as well, which is this is part of the agreement between the United States and the Taliban, that Taliban will not harbor Al-Qaeda, will not support them, will not let them operate in their own areas, and so on and so forth. That has to be checked throughout, because that's part of the agreement between the United States and the Taliban. Of course, the Islamic Republic will never support Al-Qaeda or allow it. That part, you're well aware of it. When it comes to certain other groups, from ISIS, Taliban and ISIS, at times, they are fighting against one another. So Taliban do not command, have control over the ISIS. But once the fighting with Taliban is not there, then the other groups will have little chance to operate within Afghanistan. Of course, they will not go away automatically. They will be around, and one has to focus on finishing them. But at the same time, it's because of instability in the continuation of war in a broad part of the country, in a large part of the country, that those other groups also take advantage of this. IMU and others, some of them, they may join ISIS if Taliban truly join a peace process and then they do not support them anymore. But that does not mean Al-Qaeda. Of course, Taliban have a commitment to deliver as far as Al-Qaeda and ISIS are concerned.
Now, as you know, one of the preconditions for the negotiations was the release of detainees by the Afghan government, some 5,000 or so of them. The agreement was that they would not pick up arms again, would certainly not resume fighting against Afghan or coalition forces or the Afghan people. Do you have an assessment of how many of these 5,000 might have actually returned to combat instead of laying down their weapons?
To be honest, I don't have a sort of talking about percentage-wise, something like that. But I do know that some have returned to the battlefield, which is the violation of the agreement that they had made. I do know that this has happened. I have examples in some areas, and then these people have started insurgency in those areas once they left. I would say that the majority have not returned to the battlefield. That might be the right assessment, but somehow.
Beyond that, of course, again, the whole focus here is really to get a cessation of hostilities, which have cost the Afghan people and security forces so much and coalition forces so much over the years. Do you have any sense that the Taliban are reducing the level of violence, given reports just in recent days of new renewed assassinations and violence and so forth?
At the moment, unfortunately, the level of violence is very high. The number of security incidents emanated by the Taliban in different parts of the country has increased, not decreased. And it's important, and that was part of my message yesterday in the Universal Day for Peace, that while the negotiations continue, and we assume that both sides have participated in good faith in those negotiations, it's critical that we see a reduction in violence in order to be able to maintain the popular support for the peace process on the ground. Otherwise, the people of Afghanistan will not understand. Yes, of course, One is that nobody is expecting or anticipating that in a few days' time we have a comprehensive peace deal with the Taliban, and that leads to the durable peace forever in the country. We know that it will take time. But at the same time, since the aim of this is to achieve peace and stability throughout the country, we need to prove it in practice as well, that what we can do is significant reduction in violence, which the government of Afghanistan, the Islamic Republic, is committed to that. And that is that position is very clear. But unfortunately, so far, the level of violence is very high, and to a level that is not acceptable for the people. And I repeat my call to the Taliban themselves, and also to all partners who have any leverage over the Taliban, to press on that point. That will help maintaining the momentum and strengthening it further, which is not the case at the moment.
Well, you mentioned some of those who may have some influence with the Taliban. One of the challenges, of course, has always been that the Taliban headquarters is not located on Afghan soil, nor are the headquarters of most of the other insurgent and extremist groups, again, that have made life so difficult for Afghanistan. There is a reason why the Quetta Shura is named as it is. It's outside Quetta in Balochistan province of Pakistan. The Haqqani, as you know, are in North Waziristan and the tribal areas that you know well. What is your sense as to the contribution, the role that Pakistan is playing at this point in time?
We had recently, sometimes back, we had the visit of General Bajwa, Pakistan's army chief. When he spoke with us, with the leadership in Kabul, including President Ghani, in talking about in-state, talking about unified Afghanistan, a democratic Afghanistan, a country which does not harbor terrorist groups and so on and so forth, I didn't see any difference of view in that sense. But at the same time, when it comes to the realities on the ground, yourself referred to part of it. As far as encouraging Taliban to participate in the negotiations, they may have played a role. That's what our American colleagues are saying, including Ambassador Khalilzad, and at times that there are issues, they seek their support. I myself will be traveling to Pakistan in a few days' time. This will be my first visit to Pakistan since 2008. We do believe that it is in the interest of all the countries of the region, all the neighboring countries, and they will benefit from this. And this is what they say. And then the way forward is to cooperate to put it in deeds and work together, because we have missed a lot of opportunities in the past for more than four decades, especially in the past two decades, which the world was forthcoming with support. The rest of the region was open for cooperation, but because of the continuation of the war and violence, we missed a lot of opportunities. And countries of the region also have missed opportunities. There is a lot of mistrust, founded or unfounded. We need to address those things in a sort of forward-looking ways. There are lots of grievances on both sides, and Afghans also have a lot of grievances in that regard. But the way forward is really to realize that these extremists, terrorist elements which are taking advantage of the situation, like Al-Qaeda and ISIS or any other terrorist organization, they are not serving any country's interest. They are only after the opportunities. And when the war ends, these groups will not have a foothold. Otherwise, they will turn against any country that they want of their choice. They will choose it for themselves. That is what we need to focus on, and that will be the focus of our get together, my visit to Pakistan, which will be official visit, and I'll see with the leadership in Pakistan and the leaders of the institutions there.
Very good. Just three more questions from me, and then we'll go to the questions from the audience. The Hekmatyar agreement, and you may recall, I was privileged to host a couple of the very early meetings that got that going before handing off command to General Allen. Do you see that as any kind of example for what is going on with the Taliban, or are the dissimilarities greater than the similarities?
Yes, there are lots of dissimilarities as well. But one thing which I always I've been vocal about it, and also I've gone public about it, appreciated his attitude to talk directly, and then eventually find a way to live in peace. Even today, he might have grievances because of the fact that that agreement might not have been implemented completely, which is understandable. But he took the right decision, and that's the main point. That could be the main principle. And also, I hope that there isn't any miscalculation in part of the Taliban in a way that tomorrow when the U.S. troops withdraw from Afghanistan, then there might be a chance to overcome. Otherwise, that will be a big miscalculation, and that will be a missed opportunity for all of us. I have no doubt in my mind, I mentioned in my statement in the inauguration of the Doha talks, that there are no winners in the war if it continued, but there are no losers in an inclusive peaceful settlement. With all that happened in Afghanistan, you have seen it firsthand. You have listened to the stories of victims of war in this country yourself. You have seen it elsewhere as well. With all those things which has happened, we need to put this to an end. And it cannot be done with one side. And it takes both sides. Any miscalculation in any part, in any side, will be a big regret and a big missed opportunity.
Well, as you know, no one wants an agreement more than those who have seen the sacrifice that results if you don't have an agreement. But of course, we want an enduring, a durable agreement, as I know you agree as well. You have famously contested at least three presidential elections that, again, were, shall we say, very close at the end. I just wonder the relationship that you enjoy with the current president, Dr. Ashraf Ghani, given that you have again contested two elections in which he emerged as the victor. But of course, you are now the representative of this government, which it seems to me underscores a degree of confidence placed by the president and the government in you.
Yes, in fact, it were three rounds of elections. One round was two rounds. Yes, it was altogether, yes. It became four. In 2009, I didn't compete for the second round, otherwise it would have been fifth elections. Today, yes, I'm in charge of the High Council for National Reconciliation. As a result of the agreement that we signed with President Ghani, this was a very disputed election. and even more disputed than the previous ones. And then eventually we both came to an understanding that let's have an agreement, because it was these elections were taking place at times that the fighting was going on. The United States was about to sign an agreement with the Taliban and give a push for the peace process, and all those complexities. And on top of that, had to, as if we didn't have enough, then we had COVID-19. So in that sort of an environment, I'm happy to be in a situation that I'm in charge of the peace efforts, and also what we represent is broader than the government. Of course, it's the under the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan, which President Ghani is the president of the country. But in the High Peace in the Council, there will be people which are in the opposition. There are people which are not even in the opposition, but part of the society. Very broad representation of the people. I'll be leading those efforts, and things will have its own complexities, without going into further details, I believe that there is a potential opportunity for Afghanistan, and there we need to act in a much more unified manner in order to embrace a dignified, peaceful settlement. That's necessary. That's critical. That's a must. And God forbidden, if the war continue to be imposed upon us, if the other side does not come to terms in something which is acceptable for everybody, that will be a very bad scenario. Again, we need to act in a unified manner. What I can say to ourselves, which we consider you as a friend, you could be rest assured that I will do with best of my capacity, not to attribute to differences, but rather to strengthen the unity within the country, which is mostly needed.
Well, as someone who has great admiration and indeed affection for both Dr. Ashraf Ghani and for you, thank you for that statement, and more importantly, thank you for your actions over the years. One last question from me, and then we'll turn to the questions from the audience. And this has to do with the U.S. and whether the U.S. has offered any guarantees, such as a commitment to keep certain counterterrorism forces, advisors, combat enablers, and so forth, aircraft, drones, and so on, and to provide funding for the Afghan security forces and operations and select government institutions. Has there been that kind of commitment as part of this process?
As we have a joint declaration, the same day that the agreement was signed with the Taliban, between the US and the Taliban, there was a joint declaration between Afghanistan and the United States. I wouldn't call it guarantees, but I would say that assurances are being given, not about every those details of the military assistances, but continuation of support for the institutions and also for rebuilding of the country post-peace. That's part of that joint declaration, but I wouldn't call it guarantees. So that has been put in those sorts of terms.
Well, very good. Now let's turn to the audience for the first question, please.
We will take our first question from Kimberly Dozier.
Thank you, Dr. Abdullah. This is Kim Dozier from Time. Just to clarify one of your answers to General Petraeus, is the aim of the Doha talks to bring the Taliban into the existing political structure of the Republic, or are you open to remaking or giving up that structure? And also, do your security services confirm, as the UN reports, that the Taliban is maintaining its relationship with Al-Qaeda and the Haqqani network? which is believed to be behind the kidnapping of Navy veteran Mark Freericks this year, and possibly behind kidnapping American writer Paul Overby, who was last seen in Khost in 2014. Thank you.
Thank you, Kimberly. For as far as the talks in Doha are concerned, both sides have their own views. In all those issues should be put on the table, and then the outcome should be something which is acceptable to both sides. Rather than having a precise prescription, of course I would say that certain values, including the one person, one vote, a republic, the rights of women, certain freedoms, freedom of speech, the right of minorities, the right of victims, all of those are the things that the Islamic Republic delegation represent and will debate, and then will hopefully will get to an agreement with the Taliban. When it comes to the next part of the question, Haqqani Network is part of the Taliban movement. It's yes, because of being much, much more active throughout many, many years and behind most of the big security incidents throughout those years, it has preserved the name for itself as well, but it's part of the Taliban movement. But when it comes to Al-Qaeda, as I mentioned earlier, our security and intelligence institutions, they believe that Al-Qaeda is still active. So that part of the commitment, at least, to say the least, is not completely implemented, the part of the agreement which Taliban had with the United States not to cooperate with Al-Qaeda, not to allow them to use the territories under the control of the Taliban, and so on and so forth, not to tolerate them. That part of the agreement is not implemented, at least completely.
Doctor, before going to the next question, I had a question since you raised Al-Qaeda and its continued presence. I have, you mentioned, spent time obviously in Afghanistan in several different capacities. In each of those, I went out into eastern Afghanistan, into the areas where Al-Qaeda had the sanctuary in which the 9/11 attacks were planned and where the initial training of the attackers was conducted. I must say I have never understood entirely the magnetic attraction or pull of that area for Al-Qaeda. Obviously, I guess it is mountainous. It's perhaps easy to hide there. Maybe there's some caves or some other areas in which they can seek cover. But do you have any sense about what it is about eastern Afghanistan in particular that makes it so attractive for Al-Qaeda? And now also, we should note the Islamic State as well for its element that is straddling Afghanistan and Pakistan.
Apart from the terrain, which is you can appreciate, which is highly mountainous and very difficult terrain and easy to hide, which would be the main factor, and the other factor would be that crossing the line in those areas are easy. This side and that side of the line, they have supporters and sympathizers, which they have taken advantage of that situation. That might be one main reason.
Well, and let's go to the next question now. And thanks for that, Doctor.
We will take our next question from Bernard Aronson.
Thank you very much, Dr. Abdullah. Thank you for your presence here. I worry about the signals my government has been sending for the last several years and how that undermines potentially the leverage you bring to the negotiating table. You know, the preliminary talks to set up the talks were with the administration and the Taliban without your government in the room. They've been withdrawing troops as they go through this process. General Petraeus noted that the prisoner release did not have any apparent sanctions for violations, which you say is ongoing. And in my experience in conflict resolution in Salvador and Central America and Colombia, one precondition is that the insurgents have to believe the future is going to be worse than the present, militarily and otherwise. But I wonder if the Taliban look at these signals and they hear the president talking about withdrawal of all our troops at some point, and it just gives them the incentive to bide their time and hope the Americans, you know, get on their helicopters and go home. And I wonder if there are any signals that you think the U.S. could send that would be more supportive of your efforts and send some signals to the Taliban that might convince them that this is not simply a matter of waiting out the United States.
The point is that we are, after 19 years of engagement, the United States, the partners, all together in too many sacrifices. Yes, if you are talking about the factors and circumstances and conditions around, personally myself, being part of the resistance against Al-Qaeda and Taliban in the late 90s and part of the resistance against the old Soviet Union in 80s, we would have liked it to be different, because sometimes those messages, which are part of the realities of our time, might have been misinterpreted in a way like a message which is from a position of weakness or not having any other choice or something like that, and then the friends and foes may get different impressions, but that might have been the case at, in one or two occasions. But at the same time, the United States also has been very clear about his resolve not to let Afghanistan turn into a base for those terrorist groups. That message also has been very loud and clear, and the louder it is voiced, the better it will be received by everybody. And also that part of the commitment is very obvious, that nobody want all those sacrifices to be in vain after so many years of contribution in blood and treasure. So messages of support for stable Afghanistan, democratic Afghanistan, not harboring terrorist groups, at the same time a country which respects the rights of its own citizens and live it in peace within and without, those messages should be reinforced all the time. Just 2 days ago, I received a letter from Senator Graham, Lindsey Graham, which like 150 world leaders had signed a letter in support of the preservation of the right of women in Afghanistan. Those were very prominent leaders from the United States as well as from around the world. These sorts of efforts in also being very clear about not tolerating harboring terrorism in Afghanistan anymore, those will be helpful.
Thanks for a great question, Bernie, especially given your background and experience with El Salvador and Colombia and the great work you did there. The next question, please.
We'll take our next question from Zayla Nori.
Hello, good day to you, Dr. Abdullah, and also General Petraeus. Good to talk to you and hear you well.
Hi, Zayla.
Thank you so much. My question to Dr. Abdullah, recently a lot of many member of Taliban delegation spoke to media in the emphasis on the bringing type of Islamic Emirates in Afghanistan, but there is Islamic government in Afghanistan. What is the fine line and agreement here, and what do we expect? Because people don't want to even think about it, that Islamic Emirates, once it was in Afghanistan, will be brought back, and they're insisting on this.
Yes, they will be insisting on their points of views, but those issues will be debated between both sides. We are already an Islamic Republic, and if they have certain views about the constitution of the country, they should raise it, and they should prove it that those are something that will be in the interests of the people. Those issues will be debated in a very sort of serious manner by both sides. What I mentioned earlier in regards to the to General Petraeus' question at the beginning. We are ruled apart as far as our vision for the future is concerned. And it's our ability to understand that there is no putting an end to the war through fighting in violence, and let's stop fighting and find ways that we can live together in this country without trying to impose our own views over the rest of the population. They can put those ideas once we reach an inclusive settlement to test through getting the votes of the people for it. And I'm absolutely sure that the absolute majority of the people of Afghanistan will be for preservation of the rights of citizens, including 50% of the our citizens, or over 50%, which are women. But there is no doubt that there will be tough negotiations and points of disagreements, but the agreement has to be on finding a system that we can live in peace while maintaining our differences and fighting for those differences politically rather than through violence.
Thanks, Sheila. Next question, please.
Take our next question from Peter Galbraith.
Dr. Abdullah, good to see you again. And of course, all of us who have served in Afghanistan wish you well in this process. You may recall that in 2009, we had some conversations about the merits of a parliamentary system and a more decentralized system. I shouldn't use the word federal, but with some of those aspects. And my question is, and that of course would not be just in the interest of the Taliban, but possibly of different communities in Afghanistan. I wondered whether you saw that as a possible outcome, more decentralized and a more parliamentary system than the kind of system that where so much power rests in the single president.
Peter, good to hear from you. I remember very vividly those days because you were also in the election team, UN election team, those are very vivid in my memory. There are two things in that regard. One is my own view in terms of parliamentary system. Throughout those elections that I have fought, that has been part of our agenda in political agenda, which I do believe that will better serve the interest of the people. But let me make it clear, but now I'm in a different position. I'm not competing an election. I'm in charge of the reconciliation. Any system that works better in the country. One thing which I am sure that very centralized decision-making system has not proved itself successfully. Devolution of power and authority will strengthen the country, but there are some groups which fear that it might undermine their power or authority, and that's a mentality that exists. And that's also part of the reality of our politics in the country. There are different views. So, like my personal view and the view that I have fought for it is the one that yourself referred to. And even if, to the extent that the current constitution allows it, for example, the elected mayors, we have not implemented that part of our own constitution. And there is no doubt that has led to creation of distance between the people, the public, in the central government. But what is it that we can agree around the table with the other side? That's something that that will shape the future of the country. But still, I will maintain my views in that regard, knowing the country, being in the country, and in having seen the challenges of the country. It will provide opportunities rather than challenges for the central government. But anyway, these are different views around.
Thank you, Peter. Next question.
We'll take our next question from Rina Amiri.
Hello, Dr. Abdullah, General Petraeus. It's a pleasure to see both of you. I had a question regarding the process. As I understand it, both sides have agreed that at this stage, direct negotiations between the two sides without an outside facilitator and mediator is desired. And there aren't any structures like group of friends or the type of mechanisms one traditionally sees in a peace process. Are there scenarios in which you would imagine that you would that the teams would find having an outside mediator and other such structures desirable as the process goes forward? Thank you.
Thank you, Rina. Another colleague, another friend, being involved in the elections in the past and knowing all those nitty-gritties of the past elections. Good to hear from you as well. And currently, of course, we have both sides agreed that there will be no facilitators in the room or mediators. But there are support groups which we refer to from time to time. The host country is also helpful. Our US colleagues are involved. But at one stage, if there is a need for mediator, which will be, I should say, but that depends on the agreement between both sides. We are open to that. We are open to that, but at the moment, that's the arrangement.
Great question, Rina. Thanks. And next question, please.
Take our next question from Hani Findockley.
Thank you very much, and thanks for this discussion. Thanks, David, for hosting it. My question relates to the last question that David asked before turning it to the audience, and that is, as you know, we are embarked on an election here in the United States in the next 5 or 6 weeks. And I'm just wondering, to the extent that the U.S. is a party to the discussion or involved in the future of Afghanistan, what difference would it make as to who becomes president or which administration will take over and what that difference will be?
I think knowing it from abroad and being having followed it, how much difference it will make as far as the presence of troops on the ground is concerned, I'm not sure. But at the same time, both sides, both current administration and future administration, depending on the elections, will be wary of presence of any threat, terrorist threat from Afghanistan. That part is very clear. And also cognizant of the sacrifices made in the past 20 years, in the past 19 years in Afghanistan. Will it have an immediate impact one way or another? I should say that we are not sure here. The policy, the broader aspects of the policy may continue in the same way, but you are in much better position to judge it there rather than us being here.
Thanks, Hani. And next question, please.
We'll take our next question from Manik Mehta.
Go ahead, Monik.
We'll go ahead and move on and take our next question from Bob Tuttle.
Dr. Abdullah, I'd like to expand on Peter Galbraith's question. Do you think that there's any chance out of this negotiation that there could be two separate entities, really almost two separate states, one ruled by the current government and one controlled by the Taliban? I guess really almost two separate countries.
No, absolutely not. That will be the last thing that Afghans would accept. That will not be in the interest of the country, and also the demographics of the country, the terrain, the territories, the economic dependence, and all sorts of socio-economic situation as such. And also the people of Afghanistan, in spite of all those upheavals that they have gone through in the past decades, they have not asked for it, and they will not ask for it, and they will not accept it.
Thanks, Ambassador Tuttle. And next question, please.
Take our next question from Arvind Ball.
Hi, can you hear me?
We can, Arvind.
Hi, thank you very much for taking my question. I wanted to ask you, just in terms of incentives, right? If I'm looking at this process from the Taliban perspective, you know, it makes sense for them to agree, you know, to say they want to have peace. And when the U.S. troops leave, you know, they can kind of, they have more leeway to do what they want, right? Because once U.S. troops are gone, it's hard to muster the political will in the U.S. to send them back. Also, from the perspective of Pakistan, I know they've been helpful in the peace process, but given that the ISI and the military have long seen strategic depth as the cornerstone of their Afghan policy, like, you know, from their thinking, if they get the U.S. to leave, it becomes a lot easier for them to support the Taliban or other sort of, you know, fundamentalist Sunni groups loyal to Islamabad. So I'm just trying to think, you know, from their perspective, it's probably, you know, good to have this agreement. The U.S. troops are gone, and once they're gone, they may not come back, and then they have more ability to do kind of what they want in increasing the power of the Taliban and a lot of these, you know, groups that they've been supporting for a very long time.
There might be some calculations in thinking amongst some Taliban leaders, but should this be the case, it would be a big miscalculation. I hope that's not the case. And that will be only a recipe for the prolongation of the war in agony of the people, rather than one side prevailing over the other. That will not happen. Unfortunately, should this be the thinking, then the war will be prolonged. I don't want to be pessimistic. I hope that they have learned a lesson from the recent history of the country. At times, they were in control of nearly 85% of the country, of the territory, at least, or the population, more or less. But that did not lead to them prevailing over Afghanistan, and then they lost control, and things happened afterwards. There are a lot of lessons for us. The Islamic Republic and people in this side of the line, the Taliban, the countries of the region, and hopefully that miscalculation is not part of the game.
Thanks for that question. What you did back in the day, Arvind, that'll have to be the last one, I'm afraid. I think that everyone who has participated in this session now knows once again why it has been a privilege to work with and to know Dr. Abdullah Abdullah over the years, why Afghanistan is so fortunate to have had him serving in various capacities, and indeed in this capacity right now, and really a privilege to have this session with you, Doctor, and perhaps we both should thank the Council on Foreign Relations for hosting what is almost a reunion of all those who have been engaged in your great country over the years. Thank you again very much.
Thank you, General, for presiding this important get-together. Of course, I want to thank Council on Foreign Relations for providing the opportunity and for those who participated. And nevertheless, those questions were also tricky, serious, important, and I tried with my best ability to maintain honesty, to be diplomatic at times, but I know that there is a lot at stake, not just for Afghans, but for too many people, including hundreds of thousands of people who have served in this country, which we consider them as of your troops, as our ambassadors there, and their memories, sometimes very tough, hard memories, and what we achieve will serve the sacrifice that all those peoples, Afghans and international partners, have made. Thank you, David. Good to see you in good spirit. It's very wise of you not to be seriously involved in the internal politics, but what you are doing is serving the interests of your people in ours, and I'm grateful for that. All the best.
Thank you, Doctor, and we share hopes for what may come out of this effort that you're engaged in. Thank you again very much, and thank you all.
You're welcome. Thanks.